this is another edition of Eye on Port, proudly brought to you by West Blue Consulting Limited, Ghana Oil Company Limited, and Ghana Community Network Services, BNFT, Business and Financial Times. This is a proud media partner. Today, once again, folks, we are coming to you live right in front of the Logos Hope vessel that arrived about a week ago, but began operating since the 7th of September. Now, behind me is the Logos Hope, and you see a number of people coming there. Some of them kids in uniform, kids in regular dress. They've all been on the vessel. Some of them have purchased books. Some of them have also taken advantage of the world's largest floating library and have read a lot coming out of that particular vessel. This is what Logos Hope is all about, and they are inviting every one of you, wherever you are in Tamale, wherever you are, please come to the Tema port and have an experience of a lifetime. Get onto that vessel, read books out of that library, also purchase books and go back, enjoy yourself, treat yourself to those drama series all happening in there. Now this week, the second lady was in the port to launch the official opening of activities of the Logos Hope, which is currently sitting in the port of Tema. And also it took the opportunity to invite every one of you, the public, to come and have an experience of a lifetime with the Logos Hope.
MV Logos Hope, the world's largest floating book fair and library on a vessel, has finally been opened to the general public on its second visit to Ghana. The famous vessel, with her crew and staff of approximately 400 Christian volunteers from 60 nations, has begun her 31-day book fair in Tema. The onboard book fair, which carries a selection of over 5,000 quality different titles at affordable prices, covers a wide range of subjects including science, sports, hobbies, cookery, with children's titles, academic tests, dictionaries, and atlases, among others. Speaking at the official opening of the fair in Tema, Director Logos Hope expressed his excitement about their return to Ghana after they had concluded their tour of the West African region. According to him, they are determined with their vision to make a difference in the lives of Ghanaians by improving the quality of lives of all people. He noted that the aim of the visit is to give hope to people through missionary works.
Come and speak to our crew and get to know them. They have been incredibly impressed by the generosity, by the kindness, by the friendliness of the Ghanaian people. But also, we know that this generosity, friendliness, and kindness is not only meant for Ghana, but it's meant for the rest of the world as well. And our hope is that we can make a difference.
Second Lady Matilda Emisa Arthur, who launched the book fair, urged Ghanaians and foreigners in Ghana to take advantage of a visit to enrich their knowledge through their visit to the ship to find suitable books to read. According to her, books are magic and do to the mind what food does to the body. Hence, the need for everyone to take the books seriously with a visit to Logos Hope.
Everybody here and those who are listening to us should take advantage and come and buy something for the children, friends, and family. Christmas is not far away, and there's no better gift than a book. Books are magic, and they do to the mind what food does to their body. They nourish the mind.
MV Logos Hope will depart Tema Port on 2nd October, after which she will head to Takoradi Port for another fair from 6th to 23rd October 2016, before the ship heads to the Caribbean.
Also, the activities of the Logos Hope is officially out there for the public to participate in. You are being entreated to come into the port and enjoy yourself. This is an experience of a lifetime. Ask anyone where the Tema Harbour is. Come to the harbour, identify where the Logos Hope is, and enjoy yourself. Get some copies of books and go and read. Coming up next, the terminal handling charge saga. The Ministry of Transport, the minister for that matter, has officially directed that no shipping line should implement or introduce the terminal handling charge. Yet we are told that some shipping lines are still charging. We engage the Shippers Authority, the mediator in all of these cases, to ask them what is the way forward.
Prior to the ministry, the engagement at the ministry, that's about 2 months ago,
yeah.
We received information, as I mentioned in an earlier interview, that the shipping lines were trying to introduce the terminal handling charge. And eventually the matter went to the ministry, and on the 10th of August, the ministry came out with a directive that it should be suspended.
Yeah.
Whilst GMA looked into the matter,
yeah.
And then reported back to the ministry. Indeed, GMA did their works. They did their investigation following the input from various stakeholders, including SWAG, the trade associations in Ghana, and they also...
SWAG, you mean the Shipping Lines Association, the association?
Exactly, yes. And then the trade associations like AGI, Guta, Chamber of Commerce, they all made input, GIF as well. And of course, the Shippers Authority also made a presentation to Ghana Maritime Authority. And having looked at all this, they came out with a report and advised the ministry accordingly. So I believe it is out of that report that the minister finally came out with a directive that the terminal handling charge cannot be implemented as a local charge here in Ghana.
Okay.
And following that, we have tried to let the shippers know of the directive.
So this time it's not to suspend it temporarily, as we saw in the earlier one, the 10th of August one. This is a total seizure. Stop implementing it.
That is it. That is from the directive that the minister has issued.
Okay, and this came, the date is when, please?
This came on the 2nd of September.
Okay.
Yeah, it's dated 2nd of September.
So beginning the 2nd of September, there's a total call for the seizure of implementation of this terminal handling charges from the shipping lines.
That is what the directive says, that Ghana cannot accept the terminal handling charge as a local charge.
Okay, and the reasons behind that is what?
You can tell from the directive that the minister has indicated that the shipping line is at liberty to increase its freights, you know, which is normally done, actually, world over. If at any point in time a shipping line or a principal deems it fit to increase the freight rate for one reason or the other, they're at liberty to do that, you know. So the minister clearly states that they're at liberty to increase their freight rate, but the terminal handling charge should be paid from origin.
Okay.
That is to say, depending on the terms of a contract that you, the buyer and the seller, goes into, and depending on the level of obligation or responsibility assigned to either the buyer or the seller as to where the freight will be paid, the shipper or the importer or the exporter is expected to pay an all-inclusive freight at origin.
The origin, not the destination.
Yeah.
Not, or if, between, in agreement with them, they can decide to do it at the location, at the destination, or do it at the origin?
Yeah, we have Incoterms, that is the international commercial terms.
Yes.
That determines the relationship between the buyer and the seller.
Okay.
Before the buyer, okay, engages the seller, you need to agree on the terms of engagement. And these are clearly defined, and that is what the buyer and the seller uses in their engagement. So we are very much aware of those Incoterms, and we know that if, for instance, the buyer engages the seller on a CIF basis, that is cost, freight, and insurance. Cost, insurance, and freight basis, you know, terms of
engagement.
The buyer here is expected to give to pay to the seller the cost of the cargo, the insurance of the cargo, and the freight of the cargo. So it is expected that all those things will be paid at origin before the cargo comes to the port, destination port.
Yeah.
So our understanding is that the shipper is not expected to pay any such terminal handling charge locally.
Yeah. To a large extent, that's what used to be before you know, they attempted to introduce it down here. It used to be done at the origin. Wasn't that a case?
Yes, it is.
So he's asking that we revert to the regular practice and not the new one that, you know, the shipping lines wanted to introduce.
Yeah, the minister is simply saying that if the shipping line wants to increase the freight rate.
Yeah, that one individually they can do it.
And if they want to
choose
which lines they want to deal with.
That's right. That's right. That is our understanding of that.
So are the shipping lines buying this directive? Are they accepting it? Because we gather that to some, again, large extent, some of them are still charging the THC.
Indeed, majority of them are not charging THC. Okay. We have a lot of shipping lines operating in this country. And we have received complaints from shippers that MSC is charging, PIL is charging, and International ISAC 2 is charging.
I see.
Yes.
So these three, so far, they are still charging regardless of the directive.
Delma, CMA, and is also charging.
So regardless of this directive from our ministry, these shipping lines are still charging.
This is the complaint we have heard, and our investigation
has also confirmed that.
Has also confirmed that they are charging.
So what then do we do? Because we have a national directive of this magnitude, and they still can't flout it.
Yeah, I think it's very, very unfortunate, because if a minister has come out with a directive, it is expected that we all abide by it.
Yeah.
You know. So. I believe the ministry will take a decision as to what next to do.
Okay.
But for us as shippers, we are advising our shippers to go by the directive, respect the directive that the minister has come up with. And going forward, we are also educating our shippers to be mindful of the lines they use.
Yeah.
You know, because as a shipper, you have a right to choose
what line
you want
yes.
to do business with. So what we are doing is telling our shippers that in choosing
your lines, you look at the ones that have your interests.
Exactly. You have to look at that. And we need to also educate them on the Incoterm so that they know their responsibilities and the responsibilities of their buyer. If you are well informed of your responsibilities as far as the Incoterms are concerned, then you can demand from your buyer what is expected of you.
If our shippers decide not to be using these lines, what happens to the lines? And what happens to our trade?
Well, it is business, you know, and as far as we are concerned, you have an option. If you are dealing, if you have a business partner, I think your partner should also be considerate of your interest. You know, it should be concerned about your interest.
Yeah.
So we expected that having come this far, and the ministry taking a decision,
they should be able to respect it.
Yes, we should all respect it.
Does the directive, though, come with any sanctions, punitive action against whoever flouts it?
It doesn't?
This doesn't.
Okay.
This doesn't. But I don't know what line of action the ministry is going to take.
Going forward, how do you think some of these things should be handled as far as lines? These are international, multinational business entities themselves. They do businesses elsewhere. How do we manage this so that we continue to keep relationship in trade and still be able to have our interests protected?
I think, like the ministry rightly did, they listened to both sides.
Yeah.
The ministry listened to both sides, received inputs from various stakeholders, and also try to find out what happens in other countries before coming out with this decision.
Yeah.
And to us, even though some of the shippers are not fully pleased with the outcome, they are ready to abide by it. Because in business,
you weigh the pros and cons.
Yes.
It's not all the time you
exactly.
win.
Exactly.
And you compromise. Sometimes.
You have to compromise. So we think that is the compromise position that the ministry has adopted.
Okay.
And we should all respect it.
Okay.
So that in the interest of good business relationship, we can work together. You know.
You.
So I'm appealing to those who are flouting the ministry's directive to abide by it so that we can have a very harmonious
relationship.
Business relationship in the industry.
But it appears that this hasn't gone down well with some stakeholders in the port and maritime industry at all. That is the fact that the Minister of Transport has directed that all shipping lines must stop collecting the terminal handling charges. Yet some of the shipping lines are charging. I mean, where can this happen that there's a directive from the government of a state and companies don't want to abide people are not happy. We'll be taking all of that views in the coming episodes of Eye on Port. In the meantime, we'll return after the break.
Hello.
Good morning. This is Samantha Wendy. I am sending a purchase order from SAT Ventures International. Our policy for new supplies is 2 containers to start with, but you must deliver within 30 days.
Don't worry at all. I'm going to get you the 4 containers within 30 days or less.
Bye. To get his pineapple slices from his country to his clients overseas, Mr. Appiah and his representatives have to complete a number of regulatory compliance procedures to various international trade stakeholders.
Hey, Baba, what's going on? Catch it right? I mean, how? Hey.
Using single window, Mr. Appiah has completed all his international trade procedures through one portal. He has registered his company information, applied for the necessary permit, certificates and licenses, and all that remains is for him to get a text alert for clearance and movement of goods. And that's how simple facilitating international trade could be in a single window environment. You can offer competitive services to your trading partners in China, America, even here, in a simpler, faster, and cost-effective way. Single window, the only way to Ghana's economic growth, is in our hands.
When cleaning your vehicle by valeting, steaming, waxing, or polishing, make sure the engine is also sound. Servicing your vehicle with gold synthetic oil and any quality Goil oil massages the engine, removes deposit, protects it from wear and tear for longer lasting performance, and makes your vehicle fuel pumped. Made for diesel and super engines. Remember, after every 15,000 kilometers of enjoying your ride, service your engine with Goil synthetic oil.
We are a champion. That's why I, Azuma Nelson, 3 times world boxing champion and a patriot, always choose Goil.
Ashine Pankasa. Goil, good energy.
For all ship repairs and maintenance work, count on the Takoradi Shipyard. Takoradi Shipyard, efficiency, reliability, and perfection.
Welcome back. News and activities happening in and around the ports and maritime industry next.
The International Maritime Organization, IMO, regulation on verified gross mass of containers commenced in Ghana on the 1st of July 2016. The IMO guideline, which is also expected to regulate safety at sea and the ports, ensures that containers are verified to determine their weights before they are loaded on board a vessel. Prior to its implementation, the Ghana Shippers Authority and the Ghana Ports and Harbors Authority, GPHA, embarked on a sensitization drive to educate stakeholders on the regulations to ensure a smooth implementation. Following the implementation of the new regulation on the 1st of July 2016, the Ghana Shippers Authority has revealed that the compliance levels has been very high, with no complaints from shippers who are the major beneficiaries.
Since its implementation, we haven't had any complaints.
I see.
It was just the initial stages that we had some few challenges here. But
what were some of the challenges though?
The challenges had to do with the fact that some shippers had taken their containers into the port prior to July 1st, with the introduction of the directive, they had to take the container out of the port, get it weighed before
they bring them back in.
Exactly.
Okay. So, and they weren't happy about that.
That created a bit of a difficulty, but they had to abide by the rules, the new rules. So they went out of the ports, weighed and then brought them in. Since then, I think everything has been quite smooth. Yeah.
The Deputy Chief Executive of the Ghana Shippers Authority, Sylvia Asana Owu, said service providers who weigh the containers are also taking the exercise very seriously.
Service providers too are doing their job, you know, apart from the fact that some have the facilities in their premises to weigh these containers, others have also set up commercial facilities to weigh for the shippers who haven't got the equipment in their premises. And that too is going down well. We have engaged those private commercial service providers and we have agreed on the rates that is being charged.
He said most of the weighing equipment belonging to exporters have been calibrated by the Ghana Standards Authority, hence improving the verification process.
Majority of the exporters have their own facilities, weighing facilities in their premises. So what we did prior to the implementation was to get the Standards Authority to calibrate those equipment, sensitize them, educate them on how to use the facility to generate the proper weight that is required. And it is going on certainly.
Jacob Adoko, director of Tema Port, has stated that the $1.5 billion Tema Port expansion, which is due to commence on the 1st of October 2016, when completed, will have a new container terminal, food and fruit terminal, transit and transshipment terminal, passenger terminal, oil service terminal, and break dry and liquid bulk terminal. Speaking at a two-day African Ports Evolution in Accra, Jacob Adoko said these improvements will enhance the port's competitiveness and position it as a leading maritime hub in West Africa. The Tema Port, according to him, has introduced scanning of equipment regime to facilitate trade and has also invested heavily in security systems for safety purposes.
And security is very paramount in our operations. So our waters, that is the anchorage, our port itself, are under 24-hour surveillance, both by patrol boats and by electronic systems.
The Chief Executive Officer of West Bloom Consulting, Valentina Minta, said the national single window, when fully implemented, will bring huge relief to traders and improve the economic growth of the country.
When the rice export environment was going down, it was a call to duty for everybody to ensure that everything is optimized. So customs officers, regulatory agencies, port operators must come together with the aim of reducing the time and cost of doing business, which ultimately boosts the economic growth of our country.
Jimmy Alote, the Tema Branch Transit Manager of the Ghana Community Network Services Limited, said to achieve an optimal competitive level at the ports, there's a need for purpose-built logistical infrastructure and operational efficiency.
You don't want to have a customs office that is a mile away. And so in order to process documents, somebody has to go somewhere. You want to have your banks in the port so that any payments that need to be made can be made right where they are. And I'll thank Ghana Ports and Harbors Authority because recently they have congregated all transit operations into one yard as a one-stop shop.
The Customs Division of the Ghana Revenue Authority has assured exporters of agriculture products of quick processing of their documents in order to facilitate their export procedures. In this vein, Customs Division of the Ghana Revenue Authority are engaging some exporters to educate them on the one-stop shop online system created for them to submit their export applications and other documents. Facilitators told the exporters that the National Single Window has created one portal where documents submitted are accessed by all relevant stakeholders, hence saving them time and cost.
Now it's very easy for agents or for importers to import with ease. They sit anywhere around the world. It's a web-based, and then they send their applications for CCVR to be given to them, and then they can pass their declaration.
Some of the exporters said the national single window will bring huge relief to them, aside facilitating trade in the country.
I think it will relieve exporters of the frustration they go through.
Hello.
Good morning. This is Samantha Wendy.
I am sending a purchase order from SAT Ventures International. Our policy for new supplies is 2 containers to start with, but you must deliver within 30 days.
Don't worry at all. I'm going to get you the 4 containers within 30 days or less.
Bye. To get his pineapple slices from his country to his clients overseas, Mr. Appiah and his representatives have to complete a number of regulatory compliance procedures to various international trade stakeholders.
Hey, Baba, what's going on? Can't you write? I mean, how? How? Hey.
Using single window, Mr. Appiah has completed all his international trade procedures through one portal. He has registered his company information, applied for the necessary permit, certificates and licenses, and all that remains is for him to get a text alert for clearance and movement of goods. And that's how simple facilitating international trade could be in a single window environment. You can offer competitive services to your trading partners in China, America, even here, in a simpler, faster, and cost-effective way. Single window, the only way to Ghana's economic growth, is in our hands.
When cleaning your vehicle by valeting, steaming, waxing, or polishing, make sure the engine is also sound. Servicing your vehicle with gold synthetic oil and any quality Goil oil massages the engine, removes deposit, protects it from wear and tear for longer lasting performance, and makes your vehicle fuel pumped. Made for diesel and super engines. Remember, after every 15,000 kilometers of enjoying your ride, service your engine with Goil synthetic oil.
We are your champion. That's why I, Azuma Nelson, 3 times world boxing champion and a patriot, always choose Goil.
Ashine Pankasa. Goil, good energy.
For all ship repairs and maintenance work, count on the Takoradi Shipyard. Takoradi Shipyard, efficiency, reliability, and perfection.
Schedules of vessels sitting in the ports like the Logos Hope, those at Anchorage, and those expected for the coming week, plus the Bank of Ghana exchange rate next. That's it for this week's episode of Iron Port. And next week, in the next episodes, I will be joining those kids and those families into that vessel, that's the Logos Hope vessel, where we have the largest floating library in the world. All these kids marching up there are getting into the library to read and have experience of a lifetime, a lot of books to get away, of course, buying them for that matter. So kids out there, tell your parents, next week they should all be getting you into the Logos Hope vessel, because Ion Port will be taking you inside, right inside, and take you throughout that experience. Thank you for watching the program. Thanks to the crew, Robert Nyantechi, Godwin Kabuti, Solomon Anderson, Joel Lavo, executive producers Paul Asariansa, and Abna Sewa Opoku Fosu. Also, special thanks to our own assistants, Joshua Nyakom, Belinda Agri, and Nelson Fiajo.